Good morning all. Today we are going to start with our new experiment, that is data mining from a system that is being represented in terms of a network. So before going to the experiment further, or before going to the implementation, we need to be clear about the term network. So from a data mining view, we use the word network to refer to a system that can be represented by a graph that is made of certain nodes and the links in between them. The nodes are particularly called the vertices, and the links in between the nodes are called as the edges. So many times we are interested in the structure of nodes, and sometimes we are interested in the connection that is joining the two vertices together. For example, let us suppose the network spread over the cities of a country. So in this network, the individual cities are going to act as nodes, while the connection or their roads connecting in between them, the length of that road is going to act as the edge. So we may be interested in knowing the structure of a city, or how planned it is, what is its population, what kind of economy it is having, and there are so many other things which are concerned with a particular node or a particular city within the network. And we may also be interested, if we go by the edges, if we go by the connection, in the distance in between the two cities. And if we are planning to go from a city A to another one, that is city B, then we must be looking for some algorithm that works upon their connection, that works upon their edges, the weights being carried out by the particular edges. So in this way, we can see the network as a collection of nodes which are joined by the edges and between them. Just shown here, a simple network represented as nodes or vertices and edges connecting them. It may be undirected one, it may be directed one. Further, the directed or undirected may be both of the weightage they may be carrying, and hence called directed weighted graph, and undirected weighted graph also. So these are certain examples. Okay, now let us look at some real world networks as graph. The first one that comes in our mind is an email network, where the individual users are plotted as nodes, and the email conversation between two users A and B will act as the edge that will connect the user A to user B. This may be the directed, directed also, and maybe the undirected also. And if we label the particular edge AB by the number of times they converse each other, then it will become weighted and directed, or weighted and undirected also. Next one that comes in our mind and that we usually look at is the web as network, where each two pages are, you can say, considered as the vertices. And if one page is having hyperlinks to the other one, then there will be an edge, and it may be considered as the weighted if there are there is an edge that is labeled as the number of times or number of hyperlinks coming out of page A and leading to the page B, and vice versa. And the third one is the Facebook likes network. We can easily imagine about this. Then the Facebook friends, we can also plot this as a network. Then the last one is our shopping basket example, where each item is considered as your node. And if two items were bought together in any basket or by any user, then there is an edge. So it will become the network of your items spread over the baskets. And if we just label a particular edge by the number of times those two items were purchased together, then it will become the weighted graph. Now let's move to the next slide, that is the measuring a network, means what are the parameters which are used to measure a network. First one is the degree of a network. In an undirected graph, the degree of a node is the count of all edges coming out of it. and in case of the directed graph, it will further bifurcate in in-degree and out-degree. In-degree is the number of edges, number of links coming to it, and the out-degree number of links or number of connections going out of this. So in case of this graph, if we plot the degree versus the number of nodes in this graph, then this one is for the nodes, number of nodes which are having degree 0. So it is a connected graph, so there is no node with a degree or with number of links to it as equal to 0. That is why no node is plotted here. Now this particular node is having only one link, so its degree is 1. Others are having degree, or you can say number of incoming or outgoing nodes more than 1. So this contains total 1 number of node having degree equal to 1 and plotted here. These two nodes, this one and this one, are both are having degree equal to 2 and hence plotted against 2, and the other one, this one having degree equal to 3, this one again having equal to degree 3, and plotted like that only. Okay, to correct myself, the number of nodes were at y-axis and their degree were at x-axis. You can easily get it through. Now the second one is, second measuring parameter is our diameter of a network. The diameter of a network is the maximum distance between any two nodes in the network. So for example, consider this network. If we observe the distance between the node E and D, then it comes out to be 1, 2 and 3. So observe more, you can see sharply, you will be able to get very easily that these are the two nodes which are connected by the maximum number of hops, maximum number of nodes. So it is the diameter, or you can say diameter of a network is the maximum distance between any two nodes in the network. In this particular network, E and D are separated, or you can say connected by the maximum of the distance, that is equal to 3. So this diameter of this network will be equal to 3. Okay, let's move further. Now comes to walks, paths and trails within a network. So a walk, a graph walk is when we just traverse links between nodes. In a walk, we might use all the nodes or only some nodes. We might traverse the same nodes or links multiple times. Means anything, any path or any way, when we start from a node A, then goes to B, then further C, then D, then E, then it actually constructs a walk. We do not have any restrictions upon the number of times a particular node is to be traversed or number of times a particular edge is to be traversed. This is called, in simple words, a walk. Then comes the trail. The trail is when we traverse a graph using its links at most one time each, but nodes can be used multiple times. Means to say, when we are having a constraint that we can use a single edge only once, and we can traverse through, we can go through a particular node many times, then it forms a trail. And then third one is path. Path through a graph is when neither the nodes nor the links are reused while we are walking from a node A to B. Means nodes are not allowed to be replicated or retraversed, and again the edges are not allowed to be retraversed. Then it forms a graph, or it forms a path within a graph. And the last one is a closed path, is one in which the start and end node is the same. It forms a closed path. Now the components of a graph. Now if every node is able to be reached from every other node, then the graph is considered to be connected one. And if a graph is not connected, then it means there are two nodes which are not connected to each other directly or indirectly. Then in that case, the graph will be having more than one disconnected components within it. and these unconnected or disconnected components are further called as subgraphs. So in this example there are three disconnected components of the graph. Simply they will be called as components of a graph in near discussions. Our next measure for the network is the centrality. Centrality measure actually is used to identify the most important or most influential nodes within the network. Or in other way, you may say that it assigns a score that designates the importance of the nodes corresponding to all other nodes. The first centrality measure that we are going to discuss here is the closeness centrality. This measure actually signifies how close a particular node is to the other existing nodes within the network. It calculates the average closeness of a particular node within the network. So there are particularly three steps for finding the closeness centrality. First one is we need to find the shortest path between every pair of the nodes within the network. Next is we need to take the sum of those distances from a particular node. Then after calculating the sum of distances, we need to divide it by the total number of nodes minus one. For example, in this graph, suppose we want to calculate the closeness centrality for A. Then the steps above, which are mentioned above, then this node is reachable by using one hop. So one, this is again by one hop, 1 plus 1, 2. This is by two hop, 1 and 2. So it becomes 4. This one by 1, 5. This one by 1, 6. Now this one, 1 plus 2, 8. This one again by 2, 10. This one by 2, 12. And this one C, it will be reached by 1, 2, and 3 hops. So the total shortest, or you can say minimum distance reachable from A to all other vertices is equal to 15. And as we are having 10 number of nodes in this network, so we need to divide 10 minus 1, that is 1 less than the total number of nodes, by the total minimum distance from that particular node, which was coming out to be 15. So it will become 9 upon 15 and it will be equal to 0.6. So 0.6 is the closeness centrality for node A. In the same way, we'll be calculating it for B and for all other nodes. The node having the maximum closeness centrality value is going to be the node which is reachable by the minimum distance from all other nodes in an average basis. Next is centrality measure is our degree centrality. Degree centrality measures how many nodes a given node connects to within the network. To measure the degree centrality, we have to find the degree for a particular node, and then we need to divide it by the total number of nodes present in the network. So again, for example, for calculating the degree centrality for node A, it is having degree equal to 4, and there are total 10 number of nodes, so we'll be dividing 4 by 10. It comes out to be equal to 0.40. In this way, we'll be calculating degree centrality for all the nodes, and in a way, it designates or it represents the overall connectivity of a new node with respect to the other nodes. Our next centrality measure of a network is the betweenness centrality. The betweenness centrality actually designates or represents the connectedness strength of a particular node. It means by how much weight or by how much coefficient a particular node is keeping the overall graph as a single connected unit. means what is its role in keeping the graph connected is denoted by your betweenness centrality. This centrality is calculated by following three steps. First one is to calculate the shortest path between every pair of nodes within the network. Then for each node, how many of the network's shortest paths include that node and exclude that particular node to act as the starting as well as the ending vertex of any path. The third one step is to divide the number by the sum of the number of pairs. It means the maximum, or you can say the total number of pairs possible for n number of nodes by excluding that particular node. Or you can say, suppose there are 5 number of nodes in this graph and we are interested in calculating the betweenness centrality of node A, then we will exclude node A and consider all other 4 nodes for finding the value of this third step. So 4 number of nodes are there, so we'll be having the number of possible pairs from 4 number of nodes, which will be equal to 4c2, and it can be represented by using total number of nodes minus 1 multiplied by number of nodes minus 2 upon 2. It's better to go for n minus 1c2 for calculation of this. So all these three steps, if followed, can be used to find the betweenness centrality of the node B and C. So let us go for node number node B. So for this particular node, we need to calculate how many paths are there which are passing through node B. So there are we can see that C can be reached by from A by going through B, and in the same way D can be reached from A by going through B. E can also be reached from A by going through B. So there are total 3 number of paths which goes through node number B. So this term will be equal to 3. It means these are the 3 paths which consider B as their intermediate node, and we already know the value of this thing, that is equal to 4c2, which comes out to be 6. So if we divide this 3 by 6, it comes out to be 0.5. so the betweenness centrality of this node B is equal to 0.5, and in the same way we can find the betweenness centrality of node C also, just by ordering them from an increasing to decreasing order. We can have the most influential or the most responsible node for keeping the overall graph as the connected unit, or you can say that the node, if we just exclude, if we just delete that particular node, will be generating maximum number of connected components out of that particular graph. The other centrality measure, that is the eigenvector centrality, actually represent the strength of a node when viewed from the connection to the other important nodes which are connected to this. It means that a node is will be having more importance if it is connected to the other most important nodes or most significant nodes, and if it is connected to the least significant or less significant nodes, then its eigenvector centrality score will going to be lesser. It means the eigenvector centrality score designates for the node which are very much connected to the other important nodes, and if it is connected to the lesser important node, then its eigenvector centrality will be lesser. Now move to the representation of our graphs or our networks. There are 3 methods to represent the graph or networks. First one is our adjacency matrix, second one is our edge list, third one is our adjacency list. So these all 3 methods are shown with the help of an example. Means this is the graph, then The adjacency matrix for this graph is given by this. It contains the 6 number of rows, 6 number of columns, means as many rows as there are the number of nodes within the graph. There is a value 0 between two nodes A and B if there is no connection within the graph, and there is 1 if A and B are connected within the graph, and this way this whole matrix is filled. So next one is our edge list, which it contains the number of edges, or the list containing the number of edges present within the graph. So A, B is an edge, then AC is an edge, then AD is an edge, then again BA, means one by one all edges are to be there in the your edge list. The third one is our adjacency list, where each node is followed by the number, or you can say name, of the nodes which are connected to it. A is connected with C, B and D, so it B, C and D, so it follows B, C and D. Further, B is connected with A, then C and D, so A, C and D are there. So these are the three representations used for representation of graph in our computer's memory or RAM. Mainly the edge list is the one which we'll be using for our experimental study, for performing our experiments. Now move to the project we are going to implement. Again, the same data set is used for the entity matching, means RubyForge, or you can see RF organization was there, which was managing the software projects being carried out by different organizations. Going further, let us discuss the structure of the dataset. Our dataset contains two tables, or you can say database contains two tables. One is data source and other one is RF developer projects. Let us discuss data source first. Data source is a table spreading over three fields. One is data source ID, then date donated, then comments. Actually, the overall data, this overall data is about a timestamp, or is about certain day. So this data is about a timestamp when we exported or we collected the data from the RF organization, and that particular date or that particular timestamp is marked as our data source ID. For example, here 24 is the data ID that denotes that data was collected, data was exported on 2006-7-1 at this time from the RF database. And then the third field is the comments about the data being collected. This is, for example, this is the July 2006 RubyForge run. So this table actually maintains the record of various timestamps, various days when the data was collected from RF organization. So, and the next table, which is our RF developer project, is spread over three fields. One is data source ID. It is a foreign key and is referenced from the data source table. The second field is this developer login name. Third one is project name, or you can say project Unix name. So this is our main table, which contains a project name, and under this project name a number of developers are there whose login names are stored in this table, and this all information is stored against the data source ID. So for example, if we are having data ID is equal to 82, means 82 in the data source was collected at certain timestamp, maybe in 2008, maybe in 2009, then corresponding to that particular timestamp 82, there was a project that is named as AAA Open ID, and under this project this is the developer which was working under this project. So there are a number of developers working for a particular project under the same data source ID. Suppose let us assume that there are 100 source IDs available out here, means we collected the data for 100 durations, then the data source table will be containing 100 entries, 100 rows out in this data source table. And further, suppose for each data ID there are 100 number of projects listed under this, and for each project there are 100 developers working for this. So for a single project ID or single data source ID, your RF developer project, means this table will be containing 100 projects, and further one project is having 100 number of developers working under it. So there will be a total of 100 multiplied by 100 entries under a particular project. And as there are 100 projects, so this table will be containing 10 raised to the power 6 number of rows when there are 100 number of timestamps for which data was collected. And for each timestamp, 100 projects were listed, and for each project, 100 developers were working for that. Okay, now after going through the dataset description, now let us start discussing what actually we want from this project. This project is all about the RF, or you can say RubyForge dataset. This table we have just discussed, it contains data source ID, and under a particular data source ID there are a number of projects listed, and for each project it has multiple developers working for this. So if we think in terms of network, where each developer is represented, is considered as a node, and there is an edge between two developers A and B if they work for the same project. It means if A and B are working for a project, suppose P1, then there will be an edge having weight equal to 1. If A and B are working for some other project also, then it weights, the weight of this edge will be going to be equal to 2. And if suppose there are 10 individual projects which are like this, that A and B were working together for all those 10, then there will be an edge between A and B, and its weight is going to be equal to 10. So if we can represent this whole data set in the form of a network, then it really will be carrying the information about the functioning, about the working of individual developers under different projects. So throughout this project we are going to learn how to prepare the data, how to prepare the edge list when the data in the raw form is provided to us in the form of some Excel file or in some notepad also. Then after preparing the data in form of your edge list, we are going to form the network out of this, the undirected weighted kind of network we are going to form. And after forming the network, we are going to extract some insights out of the network, means which are the nodes which were meant the most for this network, or you can say who are the developers which are, you can say, mostly involved, which are involved in most of the projects. Who are the developers, or you can say a group of developers that work in tandem. Or we can analyze the overall behavior of a set of nodes with the evolution of time, means in 2000 which projects were there, in which they were involved, and with the evolution of time, how did they, you can say, traveled through, how did they move through. So this all we are going to, you can say, execute, this all we are going to learn throughout this project. Now let us try to go through the actual raw data provided to us. So this is in the form of two files. First one is RF file. It consists of three fields, that is like this one. So there were three fields. One is your data source ID, just given as here. So this is the file containing RF developer projects. First field was data source ID. This is your data source ID. Second one is your developer login name. There is some problem over here. Okay, actually it is for data source, RF data source it is, this one, RF data source it is, which is, first field is your data source ID, second one is date donated, this one, third one is their comments about this collection that is made through. Now the second file provided with us is your RF developer projects, which is further spread in three fields: data source ID, then developer login name, then project name. So this is the file, again spread over three fields. The first one is your data source ID, the second one is your developer name, this is your developer name, the third one is your project Unix name, that is the third one is your project name. So these are the two files which are provided to us in the form of CSV. Now we have to create, or you can say we have to import them in our database. So let us go in MySQL server, start it, and after starting it go to the PHP MyAdmin control panel. Now it is been launched. Now there is a database named as Network Mining. Create it. How will you create this? Just by going to new and create your own, you can say, I suppose AS you want to create, then create it. It will be created, and accordingly you may further update this by insertion of certain tables, by further insertion of certain fields of different types. Now this NM database I've already created, under which I created two tables. One is data source, one is the developer RF developer projects. Initially data source is empty and is containing three fields: data source ID, date donated, and comments, just as per our schema. And second table is our data source RF developer projects, again containing three fields: data source ID, developer login name, and project name, just according to the second scheme. So these are the two tables contained within our network mining database. So let us try to populate the first one just by importing the CSV file that we have just gone through. Choose file, and then move to the desktop first. Desktop, from desktop to data mining, data mining to it is not here, actually it is in on desktop, further under network mining. And the first one that we are just going to populate is our data source. So this is the data source, we just imported it, and after importing we need to execute, we need to perform the insertion. So it is populated and it contains 56 number of rows, means 56 data sources are there, or in other words you can say that 56 times we have collected the data from RF source, RF website. Now move to the second table, that is your RF developer projects. Populate it again, import the CSV, that is the developers, and format is our CSV, then execute it. It will take certain time, as there are I think 2 or 3 lakhs rows present in this table. It will take some time. So after import of your RF developer projects, now it contains 245,091 rows, some of which are you can see that data source ID is 24, then developer login name is A280276 and project name is this. So like this, it contains more than 2 lakh number of rows which are distributed over different data source IDs, under which different projects are listed, and for each project different number of developers are listed. So our overall aim is to develop or is to create a network where the nodes are developers, and there is an edge between two developers if they ever worked for a single project together, and the weight of this edge will be equal to the number of projects they worked together. So this is going to be our aim of data preparation, means we started with the raw data stored in form of a CSV file, and from this data file we have to create a network, or we have to generate an edge list out of this. So let us start working for this. First of all, you need to go through your Anaconda. From Anaconda, start your Jupyter notebook. And in Jupyter notebook, I was working for data mining. Go to the data mining and further go to your network mining. And under network mining, there is a file that is named as data preparation. So let us start executing it step by step by understanding the same. So this is the first block that is meant for data connection. We need to connect to our NM, means network mining, which we named here just like this NM, further containing two tables. So name it as NM and connect it with your credentials. Execute it. Executed with no error, it means our connections are working fine. Next, create the cursor and execute it to print the count of your RF developer projects. Run it and print it. So there are 2,932,995 rows in this table. Actually the query was executing at that time when we looked at it. Now move to the next block, that is this one. So before going to this block, let me clear that now from on we are going to work upon the single data source ID, that is data source ID equal to 266. Now if we look in this data source table, then it contains data source ID, date donated and comments. There are total 56 data source IDs available in this table, and under each data source ID, corresponding developer project table contains a number of projects listed under it, and for each project name there are a number of developers listed under this. So for now we are going to work with data source ID, that is equal to 266. So for this data source ID, we want to have different number of details of the pair of developers who worked for an individual project. This is our overall aim, means we want to have the pair of developers working under individual project. So we started with that, select the project name, then developer name, and developer name again, A dot developer name and B dot developer name, where A and B both are referring to the developer projects. RF developer projects A is referring, B is also referring to the RF underscore developer underscore project. Actually, we are going to perform an inner join on this table, just to have the fields where data source ID is equal to 266 plus where the developer name in first reference is not equal to the developer name in the second reference. So this is what we want to achieve. And this is the statement to exclude the duplicate entry of the same pair. Means if A along with B has appeared, then there is no need of having B and A again. However, the order is different, but all in all they are the same pair. So this helps in removing those duplicate entries. So if we execute this query, it results in the individual pairs of your developers working under individual projects. So this is the entry, or you can say these are the details printed by this statement, or you can say this is the result generated by this inner join statement. So there are total 4671 number of pairs which were found under data source ID 266. These are the three fields, result 0, result 1, result 2. Result 0 refers to the project name, result 1 refers to the developer login name, and this again refers to the developer login name. Now in this block we want to have the count of number of developers who worked with a particular developer. That is, if there is a developer A, then we want to have the number of other developers who worked with A in one or some other projects. This is the overall purpose of this statement. So again, this logic remained the same, but in the select A dot developer login name, we extracted the count of developers, individual developers working with him. So the result of this statement comes out to be the number of individual developers worked with a particular developer. So this is the result printed by this statement, means this developer is involved with 55 other developers. This is again involved with 42 other developers, or you can say worked with 42 other developers, and this again worked with 29 developers, and so on. So it printed all the developers details. Next block. Now apart from the number of developers a particular developer worked with, we are now interested in their names also. That means the names of developers who worked with Ejombus in some project or the other. So this is the query for doing the same. Just try to understand this. The lower part remained the same as the earlier one. The only change is that here we are selecting project name, developer A name and developer B name, where the A name is equal to this one, Ejombus. If we execute this query and try to print the result, then this is of this nature means this is the project name, this is the required developer name which we are interested in, and this is the list of developers, the third column, who worked with Jombus developer in some project or the other. So these are the details concerning to a particular developer who worked with these developer whose names are mentioned in row number or column number 3. Now move to the most important block of our program. That is, if there are two developers under data source ID 266, let they be A and B. Now we are interested in number of times A and B worked together for some project. So this is the purpose of this block. Just try to have a look. Means it is executing a cursor and selecting developer name, B developer name, and count of project names, means number of projects they worked together. This is the main logic behind this. We again perform the inner join, so things remain same out here, and it is group by 1, 2 and order by 3. So 3 columns are there, and the output after executing this comes out to be of this nature. Means two developers are there, this is R2 Bhuga, they worked for 10 number of times, then both these worked for 9 number of times, then these two worked for 9 number of times. Means 3 columns are there. First one representing the developer 1 in the pair, second one representing developer 2 in the pair, and the last one or the third one representing number of times they worked for some project together. Now try to relate these results with our network formation. Now this table, or you can say these results, are enough to construct a network out of these. Means we are having this node number 1, this node number 2, and its weight is going to be equal to 10. Then again node number 3, node number 4, weight is going to be 9. Node number 4, 7, node number 8, its weight is going to be 7. So we can just visualize our network which is going to be formed using these results. Now we are having the edge list kind of thing. Edge list, where column number 1 is having source vertex, column number 2 is having the destination vertex, and column number 3 is having its weight. Now the next task is to write them in a file. So import CSV, as we want to make a CSV file, import sys for system, and then this statement is used to write in form of some rows in the CSV file. We are delimiting it on commas, means we do not want any comma in the output file. And what we are exactly doing is for RE in result is this one that we have just calculated. We are iterating upon this result, or you can say these many rows we are going to iterate, and for each row we are going to write it in CSV file. So if we execute this, run it, and its execution will be resulting in creation of a file that is named as edgelist266.csv in your current directory. Let us try to check whether it has been created or not. So go to the working directory. It was our working directory. So this one is the file that is just created. So it is edgelist. If we try to have a look at it, so it contains the same one, the first one, that is Sato and Bhuga, that is that was our result. First row was this one, the same row is copied in your file. Second row is again this one, again from here only. So in this way we have written all these rows, all these edges in our edge list, which is stored in the current directory in the form of a CSV file. So our next task will be to manipulate or to make use of this CSV file to generate a network or graph using our NetworkX library. So this will be the purpose of our next lecture. Thank you very much.